بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله الأمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We have today hadith number 128 from the blessed book of Umdatul Ahkam. And this hadith was narrated by Warrad, who was the clerk of Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah, may Allah be pleased with him. He said that once Al-Mughira dictated me in a letter addressed to Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, may Allah be pleased with him and with his father, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say after every compulsory prayer, used to say, meaning that this was his sunnah, that he always maintained saying this: لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد. Which translates to: none has the right to be worshipped but Allah, and for him is the kingdom and all the praises are for him, and he is omnipotent. O Allah, nobody can hold back what you give, and nobody can give what you hold back. The wealth and prosperity of a person will not avail him from you. Warrad said, I went to Muawiyah after that, sometime later on, and heard him ordering the people to say that. And in another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam used to forbade gossip for you, wasting money and asking too many questions. And he used to forbade disobeying mothers to bury your daughters alive and not to pay the rights of others and to beg from others. Now, this hadith illustrates that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to have or used to say a number of things after he concludes his prayer. And scholars say that before the salam, it is time for dua, it is time for supplications. But after the salam, it is time for dhikr. And that is why scholars say it is not part of the sunnah to raise the hands after every single mandatory prayer, making dua and supplicating to Allah. And they even go further to say that this is an innovation. Why? It is very simple. What is the definition of innovation? It is doing something and maintaining on doing it, though the Prophet ﷺ did not do it. And this has to be related to matters of the deen, matters of the religion. So for example, one cannot say that riding cars is innovation, wearing watches is innovation, because this is not related to the religion. However, if someone says that after Fajr prayer, I would like to recite Surah Idha Ja'a Nasrullahi Wal Fath 21 times, what is the ruling on that? Well, we have to analyze. It's after Salat al-Fajr. It's reciting Surah of the Quran on a particular number or due to or according to a specific manner. And the answer would be this is an innovation. Why? First of all, because the Prophet ﷺ did not do it, nor his companions. If you're trying to get closer to Allah by innovating, this is not acceptable. And to go a bit further, there is a difference between innovating and following the general instruction of the Prophet ﷺ. How is that? If someone tells me to recite Surah Al-Baqarah 7 times or 103 times so that this or that can happen, this is an innovation. because it is not part of the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But if someone decides to say astaghfirullah, seeking Allah's forgiveness, uncountless number of times, meaning that from this position till I reach my house, I may say it 1,000 times, I may say it 100,000 times. Is there any problem in that? The answer is no. Why? Isn't this an innovation? The answer is no, because the Prophet ﷺ told us generally to seek Allah's forgiveness. Not only that, the Prophet ﷺ also told us that we should do what is needed to be done, in the sense that Allah Azza wa Jal told us in the Quran, seek Allah's forgiveness. So no matter how many times you seek Allah's forgiveness, this is an open instruction. Unlike when someone says, seek Allah's forgiveness 1,274 times. Specifically, why? He said, if you do this, this or that may happen to you. This is an innovation. So if we come to the dua after prayer, one would say, didn't the Prophet ﷺ tell us to supplicate to Allah? Didn't Allah Azza wa Jal commanded us to supplicate for Him? And the answer is yes. This is general order or instruction. So what is wrong in doing it after every mandatory prayer? What is wrong is that we know that the Prophet ﷺ prayed 10 years in Medina. Never once after prayer, he faced the congregation, raised his hands and supplicated, and they said, Ameen. Not only once it was reported to us that he supplicated on his own, raising his hands facing the Qibla or the companions. Therefore, doing this would not be part of the Sunnah. Now, having said that, when there is a need that is not maintained every single fard, it is permissible. For example, I prayed Isha, and after Isha, I am supposed to go and propose to a woman for marriage. So after I finish my prayer, I raise my hands and supplicate to Allah, oh Allah, facilitate this for me and make this happen. Not because it's after fard prayer, but because I need Allah Azza wa Jal on this particular thing. I need Allah in everything, but I have an incident that I need His guidance and help immediately. So scholars say this is okay. There's no problem in that. Whenever you have a need, you do. But what people do every single prayer, and they raise their hands and they do and mumble with things that they don't even think about, and then they wipe their faces and their bodies, this is not part of the Sunnah. So what did the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam say? He used to say, La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, lahul mulk, wa lahul hamd, wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir. This is his Sunnah, to say and to testify that there is no God worthy of being worshipped except Him, and everything belongs to Him, and He is the only praised one. And then he would say, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that nobody can hold back what you give, and nobody can give what you hold back. And this is very important to believe, not only to say. Because once you believe in this, then your trust and dependence and reliance on Allah Azza wa Jal would be perfect and complete. And once you have this full dependence and tawakkul on Allah Azza wa Jal, nothing can harm you. And nothing can bring you down, because you believe in Allah Azza wa Jal. Our problem is that we depend entirely on our knowledge. We depend entirely on our health. We depend entirely on our bank accounts, and we depend entirely on others. And that is why you find people so worried when anything affects their income, their bank account, their salaries. You find people worried when they get ill. You find people worried when their jobs are threatened. Why? Because they do not have full trust and dependence on Allah Azza wa Jal. When you say these beautiful words and you believe in them, then you have true dependence and tawakkul. And if you have full dependence and tawakkul on Allah, Allah will give you provisions from sources and means you did not anticipate. The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, if you have true tawakkul, true trust and dependence on Allah, then Allah will provide for you as He does for the birds. The birds, yes, the Prophet said, they leave early morning with empty stomachs and they come at the end of the day with full stomachs. So the Prophet is telling us to depend on Allah. But depending on Allah does not mean you sit back idle. Depending on Allah does not mean that you do what the Sufis do. They don't work, they don't act, they don't seek Allah's provisions, but they sit in the masjid with prayer beads, 1,000 or 2,000 pieces of them, and they just say, Allah, 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 Allah. What is this? They say, we're making dhikr. The Prophet never made dhikr by repeating Allah's name. Said, no, this is one of the ways of getting closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay, who feeds you? Whatever the people give us, it's from Allah Azza wa Jal. So you're begging people. This is not the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This is not the way of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them. So you have to go and work. But when you work, your dependence and reliance is on Allah Azza wa Jal. I'm not depending on people. I'm not looking at what people have in their hands. I'm looking at what Allah Azza wa Jal has, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is why I am relying entirely on Him, and this is why He will grant me, He will provide for me, as He does for the birds. The birds leave their homes. Do they have a bachelor degree? No. Do they have any experience that supports them? No. They depend on Allah Azza wa Jal. They look for food and they come back with full stomachs. And then the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us that those who have wealth and prosperity, their wealth and their prosperity would not avail them from Allah. No matter how rich you are, would your wealth help you or protect you from Allah? There is nothing that can protect you from Allah Azza wa Jal. It would not do you any good to be the strongest man in the world, or the richest man in the world, or the most famous man in the world. This would not help you at all at the side of Allah Azza wa Jal. Now imagine that Muslims say this supplication every single mandatory prayer. And if they believe in it, Allah Azza wa Jal would reward them and would grant them the Iman in their hearts, because their full dependence on Allah Azza wa Jal, their reliance is on Allah Azza wa Jal. No matter what happens in the world, I know that it took place because Allah Azza wa Jal decreed it. So if I lose a loved one, if I fall sick, if I lose my money, I could not care much. I would worry a little bit because I'm human, but my heart is connected with Allah, and I know that Allah did not choose this except because there was good in it for me. We have a short break. Stay tuned, and inshallah, we'll be right back. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. When Al-Mughira, may Allah be pleased with him, wrote his letter to Muawiyah, who was the Khalifa of the Muslims at the time, Warrad says that I went after some time to Syria, to Asham, where Muawiyah was, and I heard him instructing people to do that. What does that mean? It means that the companions were so quick in complying with the instructions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Whenever they heard something that was useful, especially from another companion such as Al-Mughira, they complied with it. They didn't just learn things as a form of luxury. They learned things to apply in their lives. And this is what every Muslim should do. Because if you learn something and you do not apply it in your life, on the day of judgment, Allah will ask you, why didn't you do it? So it would become a burden on you. So therefore, everything you learn, you have to apply. And especially if it's mandatory. But if it's a sunnah, which is not sinful not to do, it is highly recommended that you do it. The Prophet described it as if you are riding. And this is what people use to justify what they're saying. They claim, I'm not saying that's true. They claim this, but I am also repeating it. And the Prophet says that this is haram. So the first thing that the Prophet ﷺ forbade was the chit-chatting and the gossiping. Then wasting of money. And how do a person waste his money? How does a person waste his money? Well, by spending it in things that are not useful, or rather by spending it on haram. So if you spend your money on haram, this is definitely forbidden and it's prohibited, because you're actually doing haram, doing something that's forbidden. But even if you waste your money on something that is useless, someone who has the hobby of collecting cockroaches. So he has a farm of 50 or 70 cockroaches and he puts them in a house and he feeds them. What would we call this hobby of his? Haram. Why? Because he's wasting his money on something that is not permissible. Buying haram, such as buying things that are forbidden, movies, music, buying a dog is haram. Buying a cat is haram. And people say, huh? What? First time we know this. Yes, this is hadith, authentic, in Sahih Imam Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ forbade the price of a cat. So you cannot buy a cat and you cannot sell a cat. If you get a cat as a gift, yes. If you give it away as a gift, yes. Selling it and buying, it's forbidden. Likewise, a dog. The price of a dog is forbidden. You're not allowed to buy or to sell dogs. So wasting money in Islam is haram. And part of wasting your money is buying novels, buying stories that do not add value to you. And if these stories are forbidden, then they become forbidden as well. So if you buy, for example, Harry Potter's novels or watch their movies, it's all about sorcery, it's all lies, it's all fiction, and it's forbidden for you as a Muslim to believe in such things. In people giving life to the dead, or changing them into snakes, or changing them into animals, all of this no one can do except Allah Azza wa Jal. So this would be considered of wasting your money. And then the Prophet said alayhi salatu wasalam, and asking too many questions. This translation has taken one meaning only, because the hadith is وَكَثْرَةُ السُّؤَالِ. And su'al might be asking questions, as in the case when you sit sometimes with people in a train or on the plane or in a public transportation, and the man next to you starts to interrogate you, and you answer his questions as little as possible. Good day. Yes, thank you. Where are you going? I'm going to this particular city. MashaAllah, you're from there? No. Where are you from? You married? How many children? Do you have a job? What's your job? What's your title? What's your salary? Oh, that's a lot. Oh no, that's too little. Do you have another job? You have siblings? You have family? What do you do for your leisure? What is this? What is that? What is this wound? What did it happen? And he starts to interrogate you. And this is not permissible in Islam. The Prophet says, alayhi salatu wasalam, مِنْ حُسْنِ إِسْلَامِ الْمَرْءِ تَرْكُهُ مَا لَا يَعْنِيهِ. It is part of the true Islam of an individual that he does not engage himself in things that are not related to him. This is not your business. So when someone starts asking you like this, you can either bluntly tell him it's not of your business, or you can dodge his questions. And the third way, which I usually find it interesting, is that you interrogate him yourself. So when he says, where do you live? Tell him, I live in so-and-so. What about you? He says, I live in so-and-so. You live alone or in your house? Is it rented or you bought it? And once he sees this barrage of attack, he will refrain and stop from asking you. Because whenever he asks you one question, you ask him three questions. Unfortunately, there are people that are like this. so nosy, so irritating, that sometimes the only medication for them is to give them a taste of their own medicine. And then the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he also used to forbid uququl ummahat. Here it says disobeying mothers, and this is not the correct translation. Uquq is further than only disobeying, it's disrespecting as well. And the Prophet told us that he who disrespects or disobeys his parents will not enter paradise. لا يدخل الجنة عاق. He will not enter paradise because it is one of the major sins to disobey and disrespect your parents. The hadith again, لا يدخل الجنة. He will not enter Jannah. Whosoever is عاق. Whoever is disrespectful and disobedient to his parents. So it's a major sin. And that is why when the Prophet ﷺ was once with his companions, he said, should I tell you about the most major sins? And they said, yes. He said, one, associating others with Allah. Two, disrespecting and disobeying your parents. And he was leaning down, then he sat up straight and said, to say falsehood and to testify falsehood. So this shows you how severe and great disobeying and disrespecting the parents. And he also forbade from burying the girls while they were alive. This was a tradition of the pre-Islamic era. They used to feel that girls are a bad omen. So when a man's wife gives birth to a child, if it's a boy, he's happy. And if it's a girl, he either buries her immediately after birth, when she's still a few days old, or he waits until she is like 6 or 7 years old and then he buries her. He kills her. And this was mentioned in Al-Quran in Surah At-Takwir. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. If the girl who is buried in her infancy is asked, with what burden was she buried and killed? And finally, the Prophet ﷺ forbade given withhold. So he ﷺ forbade those who do not give the needy. If there's a poor person and I have zakat, I prevent him from taking the zakat. This is forbidden. And also the Prophet forbade me from asking something that is not lawful for me. I'm afraid that this is all the time we have until we meet next time. في أمان الله والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.